that will be not this coming Wednesday night, but the following Wednesday night. Hopefully we will be through with Colossians. Although Paul has a lot of good things to say to the church and to those that are saved and are of the house of God. To set a little example for you, let me remind you, you know, every show on TV, they go back and tell you what they've covered before, don't they? You know, if you like some of the shows that are new, they usually go back and recap what's been happening. In the Colossian church, there were some things going on. There were subtle things. Things that were beginning to work their way into the worship time. And into how they worship. Into the doctrine of how the people should be saved. And we don't think about it much, but there's a lot of things that creep into our services today. Do you believe, let me just ask a question. Do you believe that the church should do anything it can to draw people in?
No.
How many say yes? How many believe that the church should do anything it can to draw people in? This is not a loaded question or April Fool's. I want your opinion. Nobody? Okay, how many believe that the church shouldn't do anything it can? I've got two that are brave enough to raise their hands. There's another two or three. The one thing that I want to share with you this morning is that this church evidently had been around for a while. They were, according to Paul, they seemed to be grounded believers in Jesus Christ. Yet they had begun to tolerate some things, some doctrines, some influences that were being brought in. And there were four of them that we talked about in our Wednesday night service or in our Wednesday night study. How many remember what those four things are called?
Heresy.
No, not heresy. What else? They got a name. The Colossian heresy. So you go home and look that up. You were close. But they were beginning to let things come into the church. And they were beginning to let those things creep in. And they creep in suddenly. And Paul was telling this church to be careful. Be careful because things are not going the way they should. And the reason I asked you that question, do you believe that churches should do anything possible to get people into church? I was watching the news, I think it was this morning, and they had a little blurb on there about beer and hymns. Did y'all see that? Some of you saw it. Beer and hymns. There's this group that's going around to bars, and they take their hymn books, and they have hymn sings while the people are drinking. And to me, they had the audacity to believe that God could, and God can if he desires to, God can work there to get people to come to church. They said, well, that people don't come to church, so we'll just go to them if it's in the bars. Let me give you an example of a man who tried that. Do you, anyone remember Bob Harrington? Bob Harrington was the chaplain of Bourbon Street. People down there in Louisiana and on Bourbon Street, how many have been to Bourbon Street? Everybody that hadn't been on the go. You won't go back. Don't go at night. And keep your eyes firmly fixed on the sidewalk. Don't look in any of the establishments. But Bob Harrington was the chaplain of Bourbon Street. Bob Harrington had a lot of good works that he did there. He witnessed to people in those bars. He was allowed by the owners of those bars to come in and to preach, to teach, and to do things in places where you would think that that's where that the word needs to be. And surely that is where it needs to be. But the one thing that he didn't count on was that a man who does something like that may wind up being eaten alive by the very ministry that he is doing. Bob Harrington sadly succumb to Satan in that place. Paul says in chapter 2 of Colossians, and we're going to look at the 11th through the 15th verse. You don't need bars. You don't need fancy buildings. You don't need a lot of the trappings that we have today for people to know Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, and for people to be strong in the Lord. What you need is Jesus. The focus of the church should not be beer. I thought this morning we were going to have to get a liquor license. It shouldn't be beer. It shouldn't be coffee. It shouldn't be things that we think draw people in. When you really think about it, Jesus' words, Jesus' deeds, Jesus' message is all you need. It stands alone. It doesn't need any of the trappings that we sometimes stick with. Paul was fighting a battle. And Paul was telling the Colossian church in his letter, and we're going to read these verses of Scripture here in just a moment, that Jesus is truly all you need. Colossians chapter 2, verses 11 through 15. In him you were also circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of the sins of the flesh, by the circumcision of Christ, buried with him in baptism, in which you also were raised with him through faith in the working of God, who raised Jesus from the dead. And you, being dead in your trespasses and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he has made alive together with him, having forgiven all your trespasses, having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which is contrary to us. And he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Did y'all understand what Paul said? Sometimes we just don't understand. We're going to switch to the message. We're going to look at that verse of Scripture again. But before we switch to it, I want to tell you something. The false teachers of Colossae are like the false teachers of today. They teach that Christ is not enough. That something else you have to do, whether it's works or whether it's benevolence or whatever, there's something else that you have to do to have a right relationship with Jesus. Salvation in that time and in that church was beginning to change. It wasn't about Christ. It was beginning to change suddenly. You know, things don't just come into a church or into your life all of a sudden and you accept it. People hate change, don't you? If she went into work tomorrow and they told you that you were going to have to change the way that you did your job and that you were going to have to change it that day, what would you do? You'd have a fit, wouldn't you? You'd go ballistic, you'd pull your hair out, you'd fuss, you'd complain. But if they slowly brought it in, slowly moved it in, they sneak it in under the radar, and you begin to change and don't know. That's what was happening at that church. They were being told that salvation that was beginning to work up, beginning to bubble up in that church, that salvation required Christ plus some things. Christ plus circumcision, plus a kosher diet. Who'd that sound like? That was the Jews, wasn't it? plus observance of feasts and festivals. And you could just keep on going with the things that were bubbling up that people had to do to have salvation. But Paul came along, and Paul wrote this letter. It's a very, very graphic letter to them, telling them that he just insisted that Christ is all that the believer needs. And you and I today need to clearly understand that Jesus provides the believer with every spiritual blessing. Now, I'm sorry if you're here this morning and you're lost, but this letter was written to the believers in the church at Colossae. But if you're here this morning and you don't know Jesus Christ, Paul is also telling you the things that you need to know if you're going to be saved, if you're going to have a right relationship with Christ. The first thing I want you to see is in verse 11. Paul is telling the church at Colossae that God has circumcised the believer's heart through Christ. Here's what it says in the Message. Entering into the fullness is not something you figure out or achieve. Whoa. Don't we like to figure out things? We like to figure out things on our own. But Paul is literally telling them that you entering into this fullness is not something you figure out or achieve. It's not a matter of being circumcised. Circumcision was done to males at that time. I forgot what the age group they were, but it was symbolic. It was a symbolic thing. That you were putting off the sins of the flesh. It was symbolic of putting off the sins of the flesh. And Paul is saying it's not a matter of being circumcised or keeping a long list of laws. How would you like to keep a long list of laws? There are a lot of people in our society today that like the checklist. Anybody ever use a checklist at work? I hate checklists.
At home.
I hate checklists. Somebody asked me one day at work, and that was before I retired. I guess that's the reason I had to retire. But they got big on checklists. And I just told them this. If you can't do your job without a checklist, you need to go find somewhere else and find you another job. If you don't know what to do, had a friend when we graduated from paramedic school. This was back in the 70s, early 70s. He graduated. And he came into the ambulance service one day, and he had this big old box. That box stood about that tall, and it was orange, prettiest orange box you've ever seen. Had three compartments in it. And he came in dragging that thing in. About all he could do was drag it. And I asked him, I said, what have you got in there? And he began to open it up. In the top two sections, he had all the things that he needed to take care of patients on the scene of an accident. But guess what he had in the bottom of the box? Y'all want to take a wild guess? Direction. Textbooks. He had a box full of textbooks. It was that tall, that long, and about that wide. And I ask him this. When you get out on the scene of an accident and someone's life is in the balance, what are you going to do? Are you going to run to that textbook and pull out that textbook, sit down and read what I'm supposed to do, or are you going to act? You can't, when you're in a situation that requires you to act quickly, you can't run back to your textbooks. You can't run back to your checklist. You have to go with what you have in your heart and in your mind. And these folks were living not only thinking that physical circumcision of the males was necessary, but they were also thinking that, well, we've got to keep every letter of the law. was doing, it was robbing that congregation of the power of God that only God can give to a group. It was robbing them of that power that God could give them, simply because they did not understand that Christ was all you need. He goes on to say, no, you're already in. If you know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you followed Him in believer's baptism, you're already in. You don't need to do anything else. And Paul is telling them that. Not through some secretive initiation rite, but rather through what Christ has already gone through for you, destroying the power of sin. Christ went through everything that is necessary to destroy the power of sin in your life. And all you need to do is not worry about those laws, not worry about the circumcision, not worry about the secretive initiation rites, but you worry about your relationship with Jesus. Christ is all you need. One of the biggest, and I've watched this over the years, one of the biggest inquisitive things, or mysterious things, I guess, for little kids in a church is, guess what it is? No, it's that baptistry right there. They wonder what's there. They wonder what's there. And we wonder about a lot of things too, but sometimes it becomes an obsession. And we begin to wonder, well, is it true that I need to keep this law? Is it true that I need to keep this checklist? Is it true that I need to submit to these rituals, secretive rituals? There's nothing secretive about that. It's a tub. If any of the kids want to come, I'll take them back there and show you what's there. It's a tub with a faucet in it and a drain. It's about that deep. And we fill it up with water when we baptize someone. When someone follows Christ in believer's baptism, it's about that deep. The water's heated. There's nothing special with the water. Who do we get our water from? Duck River?
West Warren.
It comes out of Warren County, I guess. We have Warren County water back there. It's chlorinated. It's just water. But people hold to things about being secretive, and they begin to say that, well, we need to do those secretive things. And Paul is telling them very, very clearly that you have already done that. The initiation rite, you've already done. It's not something secretive. It's something that you do when you accept Christ as Savior and Lord. And He do it because He has already gone through it for you. He has destroyed the power of sin. The second thing I want you to see is that God has resurrected the believer through Christ. Look at verse 12. If it's an initiation ritual you're after, so Paul is saying, boys, if you want to go through some initiational ritual, you've already been through it by submitting to baptism. Baptism is not, and Paul is fixing to tell you, that it's not an initiation rite. We don't baptize someone to initiate you into Christ. Pay attention to what I'm fixing to say. And what Paul says and what's written here. Going under the water was a burial of your old life. When you accept Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, it requires, and I'm going to just go ahead and say it because some people are not doing it anymore. It requires that you make a decision about serving Christ. It makes it requires that you let Him at some point, Lord, I'm lost and I want you as my Savior. It also requires that you make a public profession of faith in Christ. You can't be an undercover Christian. You just can't be an undercover Christian. There are no spies in the church. You can't be an undercover Christian. You have to get up off of that seat and you have to come down, and that's the traditional way of doing it. You have to let people know that you stand with Christ. You have to let Jesus cover your sins in his blood. And I'm talking about all the sins. You can't hold them back. You can't hold little favorite ones back. They've got to all go. They've got to all go. You've got to place them at the foot of the cross. And after you do that, you have to follow him in believer's baptism. And going under the water, when you are put under the water, that is a symbol. That is a symbol. Going under the water was a burial of your old life. You're not who you used to be. You are saying to the world, I have Jesus as Savior, Lord. I'm not who I used to be. I used to curse. I used to run around. I used to do this. I used to do that. I don't do that anymore. Coming up out of it was a resurrection. It's a picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. You go down and you come up. Coming up is the symbol of the resurrection. You are not who you were when you come up out of that water. It is a symbol that your life has changed. And folks, let me say it. I'm just going to be very blunt with you this morning. If your life hasn't changed after you've come out of that water, well, let me just back it up a little bit. If your life hasn't changed before you went into that water, it's not going to change when you come out. You'll go in a dry sinner and you'll come out a wet sinner, just lost as all get out. Because that water has no curative power. It has no redemptive power. That power belongs to Jesus and Jesus alone. It's not a part of a ritual. This is just a symbolic act that you are following Christ in death, burial, and resurrection. And you are walking now with him. Coming up out of it was a resurrection. God raised you from the dead as he did Christ. Through the blessing and the sacrifice of Jesus Christ, God gave you an avenue to come out of darkness into the light, out of the grave into life. You're really dead when you're in sin. Did you know that? You're really dead. People in our society today think that they're living the great life. Well, you're really dead if you don't know Jesus. You're really dead if the world is controlling your life. And Paul says, we are resurrected, that God has resurrected the believer through Jesus Christ. Again, Christ is all you need. God has forgiven the believer through Christ. Look at Colossians 13 and 14, verses 13, 2, 13 and 14. When you were stuck in your old sin-dead life, you were incapable of responding to God. Sin has one thing that it does very well. You know what that is? It separates you from God. It literally separates you from God. It's better than a chain link fence energized with 2 million volts of electricity. It's better than a barbed wire fence. It's better than concertina wire on top of the fence. Sin separates you from God. And when we were stuck in our old sin-dead life, and couldn't respond to God, listen to what Paul says. God brought you alive right along with Christ. Think of it. All sins forgiven. The slate wiped clean. That old arrest warrant canceled and nailed to Christ's cross. Think about it. God has forgiven us through Jesus Christ. Not through our works, not through our knowledge, not through our keeping of law, but through Jesus. That should make us the most joyous people in the world, to know that we as believers in Christ have been set free, have been made acceptable to God, have been taken out of that old sin, dead life, and made to sit together with Christ and with God in heaven, because God nailed our sins to the cross. When Jesus arose, we arose with Him. If you know Christ as your personal Savior this morning, you arose with Christ. What is the old song says? Hallelujah, Christ arose. Hallelujah, we arose. What else do we need? Why do we try to do the things that people like to see us do, when all we need to be saved by the grace of God is Jesus? Why is it we major on a lot of matters in our lives today? We need to major on Christ. Christ will set you free. Christ will set the community free. Christ will set the nation free. Christ will set the world free if they'll just listen. You don't have to have beer parties at church. You don't have to have coffee time at church. You don't have to have pastries at church. You don't have to have gimmicks at church. Man, we just probably just need to wake up and smell the roses that God has given us what we need. We just need to tell the world about Jesus. That ought to be enough to stir the hearts of people into believing. You know, when Jesus walked down the road, He stirred the hearts of people. Some people hated Him, some people loved Him. But He stirred them, and He forced them. He forced them to take a side. You were either on His side, you were for Him or against Him. God has forgiven the believer through Christ. If you want to be forgiven, Christ is all you need. And last but not least, God has conquered the believer's enemies through Christ. What's your enemy? Right now you're sitting in a pretty safe environment. But when you walk out those doors back there, I said pretty, you notice I said pretty safe. I didn't say entirely safe. Because there are forces at work right now in this group. Detrimental forces, both to salvation and to the church and to the relationship that people have with Christ. There are forces at work now. But when you walk out that door, you walk out into a world that has no use for God, no use for Jesus, no use for the church, no use for you. Listen to what Paul tells the Colossians in verse 15. He stripped all the spiritual tyrants in the universe of their shame authority at the cross. And Paul's a little graphic here. The message is a little graphic. And marched them naked through the streets. People got to see who they were. People got to see what they were. That was an eye-opener for a lot of people out there. To see what sin really is and what it really does. You know what sin does? Sin nailed Jesus to the cross. And sin took His life there. Sin took His life. But when Jesus rose again, guess what? He got His life back, and He got your life back. And all of those tyrants, all of those people and those situations that in the universe that caused spiritual problems were taken care of at the cross, and they were marched naked where people could see what they really were through the streets. When I saw the news clip on the beer and hymns, people need to see that what it really is. It sounds good on the surface. Who wouldn't want to take the hymns of faith and put them in places like that that need to hear those hymns of faith? But you know what I see? And I think if you're looking through God's eyes, you'll see the same thing. I see an effort by Satan. Just as he used things in the church at Colossae, I see an effort by Satan to make something that looks good acceptable. And he's going to ruin lives using it. And some of God's people will just fall in the way. They'll just love it to death. That's the neatest thing that we ever do. No, it's not. The neatest thing that we need to do is to do what Paul told the Colossian church. Jesus is all you need. You don't need anything else to bring people to repentance. You don't need anything else to make people understand the love that God has for all of us. You just need Jesus. So, do you have him or not? If you don't have him, you need him. You need him this morning. You need to bow your head right now where you're sitting and ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart and life. You need to tell him that you're sorry for your sins. You're sorry that you disobeyed him and you want forgiveness of those sins, and that you come this morning ready to lay those sins on the line under the cross and let him cover them with his blood. When we sing the invitation song, you need to get up out of your seat, you need to come down front, and you need to tell this church that, hey, I just made a confession of faith to Christ, and I want to serve him. You need to follow him, believer's baptism, in that old North Warren water back there. You need to show the world that you were dead, and now you're alive. Christian, you need to get off of what ails you. Sin is probably plaguing you. And you may not be in the right relationship with God that you need to be. You need to bow your head this morning and ask God to forgive you. You need to be like old David as he spoke to God. He said, God, restore the joy of my salvation so that you will understand and you will know firmly that Christ is all you need. Let's pray. Father, thank you for allowing us to be here this morning, for us to look at the words that you gave to Paul to share with the Colossian church. Heavenly Father, help us to clearly see whether we're lost or saved. Help us to clearly see that Jesus is all we need. We don't need to worry about other things. We don't need to worry about legalistic items. Materialistic things. We just need to worry about our relationship to Christ. And when we have that fixed and set, that all of the other things that we ask about or we think about or we pray about will be taken care of. They'll be added to us. Father, I pray this morning if there's someone here that has a decision to make, that right now they'll have the courage just to make that decision. They'll have the courage to say, yes, Lord, I'm ready. Follow you wherever you might lead. Father, I know it takes a lot of courage and it takes a lot of reliance on you to make that statement. But God, you're able to do it. Paul reminded the Colossian church that you were able to do it. And we constantly need to be reminded that you are above all and in all. And you can accomplish what you will. Father, bless us this morning as we sing this invitation song. Bless those who make decisions. Bless those who pray that that you'll be more in their life each day, whatever the decision might be. Heavenly Father, we just pray that you'd use it for your honor and your glory. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're here this morning and you feel God calling you to come and pray or come and to share a word or come and to tell this congregation that you've been saved, now's the time to do it.